Hi everybody, and welcome to our webinar on how to save money via effective waste management. The first thing I want to say in this webinar is I've been dealing with waste since the mid-1990s, and it is a legally challenging subject. But please always remember, whilst you may want to save money by your waste management operations, legal compliance to waste legislation, wherever you are in the world, needs to be priority. We're now going to look at the actual and hidden costs of waste. And the best way to do this is to think of waste costs as an iceberg. The iceberg is visible above the water, but there's a lot of it invisible below the waterline. So what we can see in terms of waste costs, so the visible waste costs are what we're charged for waste, whether by our waste service providers or if we're processing waste under a legal permit, the cost of doing that activity. But the invisible costs of waste hidden in this are energy costs, costs of other utilities such as water, raw material costs, labour costs, the cost of transporting, handling and storing waste, and equipment of waste management equipment, and maintenance of waste management equipment. As covered in one of our previous webinars, and I will put the link to this in the description below, the waste hierarchy is a fantastic way of reducing waste costs, because the best preferred option is to prevent waste being produced in the first place. Then preparing waste for safe reuse, and then further down the waste hierarchy, recycling, other recovery such as energy recovery, and finally disposal. As a chartered surveyor, the Latin motto of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors is Est modus in rebus, which in English means there is measure in all things, and there is measure in waste quantities, and in turn from the waste you produce there's carbon quantities as well. So you need to accurately measure the amount of waste you're producing to whichever waste stream it's going in. So you need to measure general waste, for example, recycled waste, but the data needs to be accurate. Firstly, I would check with your waste management service provider, who should be providing this information. If they're unable to, you can reasonably accurately, by inspecting your waste management and some simple calculations, you can calculate yourself what waste is being produced from your site. I would also check your waste management capacity. Do you have enough waste management facilities? Do you have too many? A case study I always like to use is a client who brought me in a few years ago to assess the waste management. They were only sending 39% of their waste away from landfill. So 61% of their waste was being landfilled, and you should be aiming for 90% diversion of waste from landfill in the UK, as a minimum. So anyway, I've visited the client and actually looked inside each one of their 110 litre bins. They had 5 general waste bins. Only one had anything in it. And this was because a facilities manager who had left the organisation had had an office clear out. So I'd ordered lots of extras, so 4 extra 110 litre general waste bins. So they had the office clear out and he didn't cancel the order. But the waste management company were sending their vehicle every week and lifting it and emptying the empty bin into their vehicle and still charging for a full load. So we cancelled 4 bins. So we had 1 general waste bin And overnight, we got our recycling rate up to 89% from 39%. So check your capacity, whether you're over capacity with your waste management or under capacity. You may need a little bit of trial and error for this, but if you get it right, you can manage accurately your waste streams and only pay for the waste that you're managing. Test the waste management market. Different waste carriers use different technology. Some of this technology can yield higher recovery rates, recycling rates. For example, some waste companies have zero waste to landfill because it all goes to energy recovery. You also need, once you've decided the best way forward with your waste management, is to establish processes. Processes that may be documented, they may be informal, but processes that work for your sites, for your waste management. I've been developing these processes for over 20 years, but my experience is let the legislation lead and the rest will follow in terms of you making cost savings. You may have the best waste management processes in the world, but if nobody knows about them, they are useless. So please provide training to all waste producers on your sites, all people involved in waste management, which will be everybody on your site. Please give them training appropriate to their involvement with the waste process. There's a technique called waste mapping that I've used for years, and it's a really easy way of identifying and managing waste streams. To do this, you need to identify the sources of waste in a work location. And once you've identified each source can be managed, and they can be managed together in a holistic manner. I do recommend all producers of waste to be familiar with the legislation, because the legislation can have its advantages. In the United Kingdom, you can obtain a legal exemption or a permit to either treat waste, dispose of waste, or store waste, or use waste. Now, there is an upper limit for exemptions, but it's usually quite a large limit, but check with your local regulator to see if there's any exemptions available. A really good example of how this works is I was once working on a project where some electrical equipment was being stripped out of a building. Now, the scrap waste management company offered £6 a ton for the cable, but they were offering twice as much as that if the cable had the core stripped off it. However, stripping core off waste cables in the UK is classed as treating waste. What we did, we obtained what's called a T9 scrap metal exemption. This was completely free from the Environment Agency in England, and it allowed our site to legally strip the metal core and get a higher value for basically selling the metal legally to a scrap metal dealer. The dealer was licensed, but even by doing such a simple thing under a permit that didn't cost any money and we applied online, we could yield a lot more money. Another great example of this is shredding and crushing waste. If you change the form of waste in any form to reduce the size of it, you do need exemptions, and there's many different types of exemption that you could apply for. But by applying for this exemption, you can reduce the amount of waste legally, the amount you're putting in your bin, your skip, and reduce the cost of waste. We hope you found this webinar useful. Please check out our other waste management webinars, and I'll put the playlist in the description below. So we've already looked in this series of webinars at legal challenges and legal factors involving waste management in the UK. But once you get the law right, you can then start with your compliance to look at the cost of waste and reduce the cost of it. As always, thanks very much for watching. We appreciate everybody's time in watching our webinars. If you like them, please subscribe. Please click on the little bell to get notifications when we put a new video up. We're still putting regular content on the channel. Thanks everybody for subscribing. We've recently got over the 1,000 subscribers mark, and this is still rising rapidly. So thanks again for watching, and goodbye.